First of all, let me just say that I loved this book.
Thank you.
As I love all of your books, but this especially after your last book, An Age of License, which they really are sister books. It's really lovely because as somebody who's read your earlier stuff as well, like I read French Milk and all of that stuff, you have a very, I think, a distinct way of doing travelogues that it's very distinctive. It's a very Lucy Knisley way of doing things. And to see you return to that is really awesome. And just like for, you know, people who may not know how you do travelogues, you want to talk a little bit about how you put those together and what the experience is like?
Sure. As Marie mentioned, my first published travelogue was called French Milk. I wrote it when I was 20 or so, 20, 21. And I sort of set myself a challenge. I was about to graduate from art school, and I wanted to see if I sort of had it in me to bring this into a storytelling realm. I was already making comics for my school newspaper, but I sort of wanted to tell longer form stories. So my mother was turning 50, and I was about to graduate, so we're sort of at these turning points in our lives, and I had the sense that it would be something that I wanted to sort of memorialize in this way. And so I began to keep a drawn journal. I wrote every night, and I would draw every night. And this is something that's incredibly difficult to do in most travel cases. Like, most of the time you're like not, at the end of the day, like walking around all day and eating and seeing the sights, you're not like, oh, I'm gonna spend 3 hours now like drawing about what I just experienced. So it was really sort of a effort of will to do this. And as I did it, I sort of started to develop an instinct and started to develop the sort of the muscle memory that it takes to do this, and kind of got addicted. So I came back, and you know, this thing that I'd sort of set myself as an exercise was more of a story about mothers and daughters and travel and food, and I wanted to sort of share that and continue to do it. So the travelogue thing, It's really an addiction problem of mine. I have the rare trip where I won't keep one. I usually set myself like a page limit. But for certain trips like this one, I sort of let myself get a little out of control. What's nice about travelogues is that they can allow you to kind of see it from a little bit of a distance while you're experiencing it. So if it's something that's difficult to undergo, like sort of being in close proximity to my grandparents in this particular instance, and watching their slow decline, which is very scary to face on your own in an ocean. It was really nice to sort of give myself a little bit of distance and sort of process what I was going through at the time through doing this, and to tell the story of this experience and try and find the humor in it.
Yeah, this particular story, Displacement, takes place during a period of time. It's February 2012, right?
2012 or 2011.
Yeah, and basically, like, that's almost 3 years ago now. And I was wondering, you know, the book itself deals a lot with, you know, fear of aging and dealing with the weight of responsibility. And, you know, obviously it is a kind of a trial by fire. And what I wanted to ask was, now like 3 years after the fact, do you feel like that experience has changed the way you kind of encounter those things?
Aging, you think?
Aging and responsibility.
Well, it certainly changed the way I encounter the cruise ship industry. Because I had only experienced, I had been on a cruise trip before when I was very young. We went on like a family vacation there. But I'd never really experienced what it's like to go on one of these, on a cruise ship. And given I was traveling with like an elderly tour group, so it wasn't like perhaps the typical thing that you might experience
not
on a cruise
sexy.
Ship. Yeah, not sexy, not the way that they show it in the like Royal Caribbean ads. But I found myself to be not a cruise person. I'm not a person who enjoys that. I found it to be terrifying. You're like trapped on this boat that, by the way, this particular ship that I was on had been shut down for the last two voyages that it had gone on due to norovirus outbreaks, which is like this horrible thing that happens on cruise ships all the time because you're in this enclosed environment and everybody just spreads their horrible germs to each other. each other, and then everybody just throws them up everywhere, and it's just terrible. It's a terrible thing. So the last two ships that had gone out, the last two voyages that the ship had gone out on had been shut down because of this. So I have these like ailing grandparents who are already so unwell, and I'm just imagining like, oh great, this is when I got to my room, it was cordoned off with like, do not enter, sanitation progress happening, and I was like, we're gonna die on the ship. This is horrible. The ship has become like a metaphor for mortality, and it's just the ship of death and disease and horror. So did not enjoy cruises, as it turns out. Not a fan. And it was so funny because I met so many people on this trip who were like, this is our 9th cruise. We do this for every vacation. And I'd be like, what's wrong with you? That's great. So it changed the way that I sort of think of myself, because I was like, it turns out I'm not that kind of person. And you know, with my grandparents, it was just really nice to spend some time with them and to sort of get some one-on-one time, because often we're sort of, it's, you know, our one-on-one time is diluted with other family members, and to sort of have this nice experience. I'm one of the oldest grandchildren that they have. I've probably had the closest relationship to them as a grandchild, but, you know, I get sort of lost in the fray of younger grandchildren, and so it was really nice to have this time to connect with them and hide my growing panic and dread from their lives. So it's changed. I don't know. I just turned 30 yesterday, and I was totally okay with it. So I'm like, age, yeah. All right. Should
always
be fine.
Yeah. Thumbs up to aging.
Thumbs up.
But, and that's actually something that I wanted to talk about as well with the relationship with your grandparents. One of the things that I really loved about the way you sort of framed this book is that, you know, with every day, which is almost like a mini chapter in and of itself, you have a section of your grandfather's war memoir. And it's, first of all, it's a really interesting look into your grandfather's life as well as your own family history. And something that I see a lot of in your work is about how storytelling can kind of transcend time and space. And it's something that I noticed, like, especially with, you know, when you did Relish and then An Age of License, there's always this, you know, constant cyclical feeling to it. And I just wanted to kind of ask, you know, especially with your grandfather's memoirs, were those things that you were including as you were doing the travelogue while you were doing it? Was it kind of a thought afterwards to sort of bookend each of the chapters?
That happened really organically. I was rereading the memoir at the time because I thought that I would pry more information out of my grandfather over the course of this trip, and I wanted to sort of talk to him about the details. The story is so incredible. My grandfather, like, he crashed his plane a bunch of times and just, like, walked away from it, like, in enemy territory, and he was just like, yeah, fun.
He didn't wear a parachute either.
He wouldn't wear a parachute. Typical. I have no idea how he survived. He was amazing. He didn't have guns on his plane. Also, he was a scout pilot, so it was like a light plane. So like other planes all had guns, and he didn't have any guns. So he just like fly away. it's insane. So it's a really cool story. And I was rereading it because I wanted to talk to them about it. And it's something that they both are so grounded in this period of time. Both of them have such vivid memories of their wartime experiences, and they don't remember, like, you know, 10 years ago, they don't remember what they ate for breakfast. So I really wanted to read this and sort of have this thing to talk to them about, further in depth. And it was interesting because I think that something that can happen with memoir is other characters become dehumanized a little bit. Like, you're seeing everybody through, in this case, my point of view. And I didn't want that to happen with my grandparents. I wanted, especially with my grandfather, to sort of see them, see the loss of their sort of identity as human beings, and I wanted to represent that somehow. And I thought this was a really good way to sort of show these incredible stories that my grandfather has gone from being the storyteller to being the subject of the story in this way, sort of flipping back and forth, and how frustrating and sad and how representative of the sort of decline of loved ones can be in that way, to sort of watch those memories just vanish.
It's interesting because you are pretty much known for your autobiographical works, and it's largely like your roster of stuff. And
it's interesting, like, you know, it's always fun to hear you talk about autobio because it's very much, I think, a personal thing. It's an intimate thing. And a lot more people seem to be doing it now. But what's always stood out to me with your autobio stuff is that there's always this, like, sense of, like I said, sense of intimacy. Like, I feel, like, even before I met you in person, I feel like I know all these facts about you. And it was the kind of thing where I had kind of wanted to get onto this topic about what, first of all, you know, like, what about autobio do you think is so engaging for readers? And, you know, what about it for you as a storyteller, like, you know, makes you want to continue doing it?
A horrible sickness and compulsion. I love autobio, and I read a great deal of it, and it's so great, as you said, that so many more people seem to be doing it. And we were talking a little bit about Alison Bechdel backstage, and how interesting it is to see how much control the autobiographical memoirist has. When a prose memoirist will write, it'll be, you know, here's how I remember it, and with a graphic novelist, it'll be, here's how I remember it, and here's what it looked like, and it sort of adds this extra layer of experiential reading that the reader gets to sort of see through their eyes, not only sort of imagining what they saw, but to sort of really see their interpretation fully. And I love that aspect of control. I think it totally feeds into this weird persnickety thing that a lot of us have, this, like, everything, right angle kind of thing. And I think that that allows me to be less crazy in my personal life, that I can be that crazy in through telling my personal life, and to take these stories that can be difficult or that I particularly want to memorialize, and sort of take them outside of my body and share them with people, and allow that control to then be taken away from me, because the reader is then, like, able to see the story and able to sort of interpret it as much as they want to. And I love that. I love that dichotomy. I love that it's sort of the me of 2011 when I was on board this cruise ship is so different from the me at present, and that I can go back and sort of read that story, and it seems like someone else. It's like I've taken that story and put it outside of myself. And I have the memories, of course, still, but it's a little like looking into a pensieve at times.
Like, I can go and like Harry Potter.
Thank you. I thought I'd drop that right down there. that I'm able to create a Horcrux in each book, and then look upon it. So my soul has now been split into many parts. I could keep going.
I'm gonna die.
So I'm Lord Voldemort. That's why I make autobiographical comics.
You heard it here, folks. Lucy Knisley is in fact Lord Voldemort.
It's true.
So now, you know, talking about your books and the subject matter that you choose to write about. Now, obviously, you have the limited subject matter of your life, which is not limited at all. Of course, you have a rich, amazing life, I think. But
sure.
No, but it's interesting to, like, it's always interesting to hear about, like, the things that you're writing, because, you know, Relish was a collection of stories about food. This and An Age of License are stories about travel. Your next book is going to be about the wedding industry.
Yep. Yes. So the book I'm working on right now is about weddings, and in particular, sort of the story of what happened when I got married to my husband, and how unexpected that was for me. I went from being, like, very single, we were not together, and sort of feeling very complicated about weddings with divorced parents, and sort of having feminist ideals, and sort of my thoughts about weddings hadn't coalesced. And then when my ex and I got back together and we were in love and we wanted to get married, I sort of had to examine those feelings about weddings and society and, you know, what it meant to get married and the divorce rate and all these things. So this sort of began to coalesce into a book. And also, of course, there's all these, like, DIY your own table decorations and stuff like that, because, again, I'm like a control freak, crazy person who was like, I'm gonna make everything for this wedding. So it's like a combination of sort of musings about weddings and how insane the wedding industry is. I don't know how many of you guys have gone through this, but, like, it's nutso potatoes. It's all, like, the just buying a dress is, like, I had no idea that, like, what was involved, that you have to make an appointment
and like somebody has to put it on you, and like I don't even like buying jeans. Like this was just insane. So it's a little bit about that and a little bit about just what I was thinking. What was I thinking? And then like, you know, streamers. Pretty. So I'm working on that right now. It's only been about 5 months since the wedding, and so I've been working steadily ever since then, and trying to like get it down with as much immediacy as I can, because I love these sort of far removed memoirs like Relish, which is about my early childhood, and I love the immediacy of the travelogues that I do, and I'm kind of trying to merge those two a little bit in this book.
Yeah, especially with the format, when you look at Relish, it's much more, I think, structured. It feels yes. much more like a, I mean, it basically it feels like you plotted it out with thumbnails, and it looks gorgeous, as all of your work does, but it's interesting when you compare it side by side with your travelogues, because they feel much more immediate. They feel like they're happening. And that's something that I like, the fact that in Displacement you've got a lot of these kind of these little like almost scenes in miniature of something as it's happening to you. And I can imagine you like sketching that out as somebody, you know, somebody's telling you not to put your fingers in the
right
in the thing.
I'm like, ooh, yeah. I'm gonna show them. Draw them ugly.
But yeah, it's and that's actually something that I wanted to bring up too. Not germs are drawing people ugly, but once again, there's, you know, with your readers, there's this intimacy of autobio, and I feel like I'd like to ask you, like, what has been in your own personal experience, like the reaction of, like, how does that relationship coalesce with the, like, that relationship with your readers?
You mean, have I ever gotten in trouble?
Well, maybe. If you have an interesting story, I want to hear it.
I mean, I believe very strongly that comics shouldn't be used as a weapon. So I actually didn't draw that person ugly. They were like totally fine. I try and be very understanding and to represent people as their best selves in my work, because I mostly think the best of people, and I want that to be reflected in my work. But from time to time, someone will really like chew me out, and I'm like. You're gonna be sorry, I'm an autobiocomic artist, which is like the worst thing. That's exactly what I try not to do, which is to use comics as a weapon. I remember that my roommate and I were fighting once, and I was like, ooh, it's too bad that I'm making this comic about our experiences together. And she was like, you can't make a comic about this. And I respected that, and I was like, all right, fine. The only time I've ever really gotten in trouble was with my grandmother, who like won't read my work anymore. Not my grandmother in Displacement, my grandmother on my other side. She's a lovely lady, but from a different time, and says silly things sometimes, says like awful things. And we were down there for a visit, and I was still in college, I think, and I was just doing like little journal comics, and we were like out to dinner, and the waiter came over, and he was like really cute, and I was like, ooh, our waiter's really cute, and my grandmother was like, if you marry a black person, I will come back and haunt you. And I was like, holy crap, what are you talking about? And she's a lovely lady in many regards, but I was horrified, of course. So I put in a comic in my self-righteous like college-aged fervor, and that comic ended up being like self-published in a book of my student work. And, you know, it's not a book that I would generally send my grandmothers. There's, like, bisexuality and drug use and drinking and, you know, various things that art students care about. And so I just didn't happen to send this one to my grandmother. Just skip over that one. And some busybody neighbor of hers bought it for her and was like, Gloria, you need to see this that your granddaughter did, and gave it to her. And then she read it, and she didn't have any problem with the sex, drugs, rock and roll, but this one comic about this horrible thing that she actually said, like, this just so upset her, and like, I'm totally out of the will. Every time we see each other, she's like, what are you working on? I'm like, I'm doing another graphic novel, and she's like, oh god, another one. We get along fine, it's fine, she's forgiven me, but I think my comics career is not really that impressive to her at this current time.
And see, now it's these kinds of things and, you know, parts of your life that you choose to share where you, I feel, and it's true, I think, of a lot of autobiocomic artists who, you know, do share parts of their lives that they, you know, that they want to talk about. But you're sharing it with people on the internet who you've never met before, and it's an interesting thing. I don't want to talk about the negative stuff, but more just, like, do you feel as an autobiocomic artist that that creates, that that breeds, like, a more intimate relationship with your audience?
Definitely. I mean, it is. And I find that most people feel more uncomfortable meeting me if they've read my work than I feel meeting them, because it's all curated work. It's, you know, it's very flattering to me that people read these closely enough and remember them and are affected by them enough to be like, how's your cat, Linny? And I'm like, you know, let's talk about my cat. This is awesome. Yeah. And I would never want anybody to be, like, you know, freaked out to say something around me. Like, I don't want my grandmother to, like, well, okay, I want my grandmother to stop being racist. Like, that would be awesome if that could come out of this. And she does, like, watch her mouth around me now. And I, you know, when I was, like, I called her up to apologize, and I'm like, I'm really sorry that hurt your feelings, but, you know, perhaps you should consider what you say in general, but especially around someone whose job it is to, like, write down what they hear and like share it with people and like be a little bit more accountable for what you say and do. So she's a little bit like more reserved around me, but I don't want that to be the result of my job. Like I don't want people to be freaked out that I'm gonna, like, they're gonna tell me an embarrassing thing that happened to them, and I'm immediately gonna turn around and like, oh, that'll make a great comic. I always ask permission. And with, you know, with the sharing intimate details of my life, it's very important to me to sort of have this dialogue, to feel this connection. It's why I do this. It's, why I like to make these comics, to have that connection. Like I said, even if it's just to a future version of myself, but most especially to other people. And I love that. I love talking to a reader who's been, affected by my work, who feels a connection to me through my work and, you know, wants to talk about my cat for the next half hour. Like, great. That's awesome. And people will be embarrassed. Like, you know, people will be like, I feel weird that I know Sipper Abbott. And it's like, no.
I know I was.
Right? Yeah. But like, no, that's awesome. I love that. I'm not sharing things that I'm not comfortable sharing. And, in most cases, I haven't had a great deal of creepiness and creepy weirdness. Every once in a while I'll get like a anonymous letter at a convention where I'm appearing, and someone will just like slide it across the table and then run away, and I'll be like, okay. And usually, you know, it's more about them than about me, and the way that they live their life and experienced my comic through their own lens, than it is about what I experienced and what I shared with them. And that's, you know, that's great. I love to have that effect on readers. I love to feel that connection, and, you know, meeting people who've read my books in that way is the best part, because I can sort of have that back. I can sort of feel that back from people who have felt that in one direction.
To bring this back kind of to Displacement, I feel like you were talking a little bit about this, about, you know, the cruise ship industry, the wedding industry. I feel like, I think it's natural that, you know, in our lives we encounter things that, you know, either social commentary or social contemplation. And I feel like there's always kind of a running theme of that in your books. Like, you're not afraid to discuss that, and you're not afraid to, like, really dive into that, especially, like, within your own internal monologue. You do that quite a bit also in Age of License.
Thank you.
And, yeah, it's really cool.
Yeah, I loved what you said about the books being sister books. I agree. I want to, like, belly band them together and, like, sell them as a pair. Because they were made in, like, within a year of each other, and it was like this year of my life that was, again, sort of like shifting sort of point of view, and about adulthood, about young adulthood. The first one being sort of like freedom and excitement and travel and sex and fun and sort of discovery, and the second one being sort of everything that tethers you back to the ground, your family and sort of mortality and society and
responsibility,
yes, and how you know, finding your place as an adult, finding, like, you know, am I a cruise person, am I not a cruise person, turns out I am not. And sort of trying to connect with your history, and it's like an appealing juxtaposition, these two books that I think everybody sort of experiences these two opposing forces kind of pulling you in both directions and finding a balance between the two?
where are we? Do we still have time?
A ton of time.
Good lord. I did not prepare enough questions for this. But no, so moving on, like, into, you know, making comics as a professional, as a young professional, like, what I guess I want to ask, you know, what is your perspective on the comics industry, how it's changing, how people like yourself are changing it, and, you know, what books like Displacement, what books like, or you know, other graphic memoirs about, you know, people within our age group, Liz Prince's Tomboy, and,
Awesome book.
Or Jess Fink's book, We Can Fix It.
Yeah.
You know, books like that that are really communicating the perspective of this younger generation that's really up and coming and becoming much more, I guess, I don't want to say powerful, but like more influential in comics. Like, what is your perspective on that as being a part of that?
Well, it's really interesting. And I think this is also growing in other generations. I think that there's a lot of power in younger women specifically, telling their stories, telling personal stories, as a voice that hasn't been so heard in the past. But for example, Roz Chast's book this year, as an older generational book, which I only read recently, and I was like, man, she totally gets it. She totally says it way better than I did in Displacement. But this is great that, like, people are talking about this. You know, there's visual humor, there's written humor. About the aging process at that age, and sort of like dealing with the decline of her parents and sort of her own place in that, and that I'm sort of writing from a generational gap the same story, which I think is so interesting. And yes, there are all these really great stories coming out. I love these personal stories. It's so fun, and it's so fun getting to meet the people that write them, and see things like Alison Bechdel is so beautiful, and she has the most beautiful hands, and all of her characters in her books have the same hands. They have these really beautiful, elegant hands, and it's so cool to have this connection to the real person, and then to see it so reflected in their work in such a visual way, how beautiful these hands are. And I love that kind of thing. I love meeting Liz Prince. I've known her for years, of course, but like when I read Tomboy, I was like, I know exactly that shirt that she's drawn herself wearing. Like, she wears it to every convention she ever goes to. That's awesome. So I love sort of like that people are writing fan fiction about themselves. And I'm like, yes, I'm already fans of these people. Jess Fink and I were like live journal buddies in high school, and so to see her writing books like about her past and sort of being this incredible artist and seeing her work published is so exciting to me. And these are all like dumb personal stories about like why I particularly love those particular books. But it is so great to see that, because I think when I was coming of age, there was a lot of male voices in the personal comics sort of memoir field. There was a lot of Craig Thompson going on. There's a lot of Art Spiegelman going on. And this was really wonderful, wonderful stories. But it's so great to me to see how many younger women are now telling their stories and sort of gaining a voice in this regard, especially considering the sort of traditional male-dominated superhero comics field. That women have sort of taken over the graphic memoir thing in a way. I was just talking about this the other night, that a form is only legitimized when it's like becomes male dominated, and it's like women started writing novels, and then like as soon as men started writing, then it was like, oh, a woman's thing. But as soon as men started writing novels, it was like a woman's novel. That's for like, you know, that's mommy literature. That's chick lit, which is so like, come on, guys. So it's interesting to sort of see that this field of graphic memoir was male dominated, and that like now it's been taken back by women. And I just think that's so interesting to watch them all slowly pop up like mushrooms.
Yeah, and it's definitely, there's something to be said about the all of these stories, which, you know, are being disseminated either through publishing or even just through like personal blogs on Tumblr and stuff like that. I definitely follow quite a few different people. And it's the kind of thing where it's really heartening to see that these women can share goofy stories about their everyday life. It's really lovely that there's not, I think, a huge pressure to make like huge, sprawling, you know, fantastical epics, that you can have just as much, you know, success and happiness and satisfaction from, you know,
and find a readership.
And find a readership. And find a readership just talking about your goofy adventures, being yourself. You know, that's really, I think, wonderful, especially for like young women to be reading about.
Well, I remember when French Milk came out, I got this hilarious email. And like, keep in mind, I was 20 when I wrote this book, so I was like about to graduate from college, and I was full of doubt and insecurity, and you know, fighting with my mother on a trip, and like getting my period everywhere, and like just whatever. And I got this email from someone who was like a woman who'd read my book, and she was just like, I think it's terrible that you're depicting this character as such a weak female presence, and like, this is, you should be like showing strong female characters. And I was like, I don't know what to tell you, but I'm a real person and I'm a woman, so like, I think I should be allowed to like get my period and fight with my mother and be a big baby, and still be considered a strong female character. But it's also like, I'm telling the truth here. I'm not trying to show myself as like saving the world. I'm not trying to only filter my thoughts in terms of like, here are my selfless thoughts about, you know, Kierkegaard. I'm trying to show, you know, what you experience as a 20-year-old about to graduate from art school who is like having a panic attack. So I just thought it was so funny that I got this email. I think I didn't respond because I was just like, oh, am I not a strong female character? I sort of thought I was, but
The Kate Beaton strong female characters.
Yes.
Sexism is over.
This is over.
But and there was something I was going to say about that. Oh no, and like, you know, an example in Displacement where there's a really great bit that you put in that stuck with me, where you're intellectualizing the reason for why you're doing this, why you're shepherding your grandparents through this cruise, and you're asking yourself, am I doing this because I actually love them? Am I doing it like out of selfless reasons? Am I doing this out of selfish reasons in order to like, you know, feel better about myself? And then in like the whole thing just ends with you, I think you like hand your grandfather a lemonade or a cup of water or something. And it's so telling, and I think it's such a mark of, I think, why your books resonate so much with people, that on one hand, yes, you show yourself at your lowest points, you know, getting your period and fighting with your mom in France or having a panic attack on a cruise ship, but it's also wonderful because then you draw yourself and you feel like a real person to the people who read you. And I think it's great that you're able to communicate that doubt, because I think people can relate to it.
I think it's easier for someone to see a character who, like, you know, is a mess and still a strong character, and to then reflect that in their own lives. And for me, it the most important and like reassuring thing that has happened to me in my 20s is to realize that like nobody has their shit together. Like nobody knows what they're doing, and everybody like needs to give themselves a little break here, because I had perceived the world as everybody else totally has it together and they're like on top of everything. And I think it's really nice to see that's not the case in a lot of cases. And I try and reflect that in my book, that I'm honest about what goes through my mind at certain times. And I think it is easier for people to get through a day thinking like, oh, there are other people that like want to hurl themselves off the deck of this cruise ship, rather than like, you know, it would really keep me up at night if I thought every single person would be like, this is our ninth cruise. We just love the all-you-can-eat buffet so much, even though it's full of norovirus. So good. If every single person on Earth was like that, and I was the only person who was internally screaming at that point, I would hate to live in that world all by myself. So it's really nice to sort of be able to connect to readers in such a way that they know they're not alone.
So no more cruises.
No more cruise, never again. I remember I was doing some travel writing after that, and somebody offered me a free cruise, and I was like, I'm really sorry, but I can't. I'm sorry.
Are there any, in the future, if you do more travelogues, are there any, like, projects or places that you really would like to go and experience and make something out of that?
When I was doing my travel writing stint, I went to Africa, which was awesome. And I think it was not what the people who sent me there wanted. Like, they sent me there and they were like, write about the, you know, the bullshit hypocrisy of colonialism. And I was like, yeah, I'm going to think about that a lot. And then I went there and I was like, elephants! This is amazing! So, that was such a freaking magical place. Like, I really want to go back there and, like, maybe think a little bit more about, like, the horrors of colonialism. But, like, also just, I don't want to see those elephants again. And, like, oh, they're so beautiful. So I'd love to go to Africa again. I don't know. I think the travel aspect of the travelogues is secondary to the, like what I said, the sort of shifting tectonic plates of my life aspect. But a trip is a very excellent way to sort of memorialize that. And also, when you travel, you sort of have a little distance from your life, and you can see that from afar, and you can sort of say, oh, something is happening to me here. I am growing and changing and learning and loving. So I think the travelogue aspect, the actual trips themselves, is secondary to telling the story of a period of my life. So I think that to say, like, oh, I want to go to Costa Rica and write about that, like, yes, I would love to do that, but I think the only way that a travelogue would come out of it, because I've done a great deal of travelogging that never has seen the published page, that has just languished in a pile, because it does, there's no further story other than, like, elephants. Like, I didn't, the Africa piece was published in Sever magazine, because they actually wanted me to write about the food too, but I was mostly like, elephants. Yeah. But there's no real story there other than elephants. Whereas in Age of License, in Displacement, there's more going on sort of underneath the elephants.
Yeah, it's really the undercurrent of your own, I guess, really your own coming into that period of your life. And,
yeah.
Yeah, and I mean, that's one of the things that makes these so great, because it's not just a travel, you know, it's not just an account of being on a cruise. It's so much more, I think, I would dare to say meaningful than that. It was meaningful to you, obviously, and I think it becomes meaningful to the people who read it.
Yeah, I mean, I hope it helps people to know the dangers of cruise ships. No, I hope it helps. I hope it becomes meaningful to people who would need it, perhaps.
Yeah. Oh.
Yeah, we have some time for a couple of questions. If anybody wants to ask Lucy or Marie anything,
I think there's one right there.
I really like Age of License. It was a really incredible book.
Thank
I
you.
I really enjoyed it. And something I really like about your work and your art is that I feel like there's always like a really focused like food or travel or it, like flipping through this one, like the army, like your visualizations of like how his army days were. What's your process like when you do things that are so
to pick my vehicle?
yeah, like, I guess like the research that goes into it. Because I mean, like, I guess with food and travel, like you can see it, but still, there's always seems like there's like you know so much more about it. When you get look at a picture, you can almost feel that like she knows about this.
Awesome. Well, thank you. That's great to hear. With food, with relish. When I sort of set out to tell the story of growing up, I couldn't tell it without being like, well, the whole thing happened in involving food. Like every sense memory that I have from growing up was about food and cooking and experiencing food in some way, which is really nice because like our sense memory is so much stronger than other memories we have. So it was a really nice vehicle for me to tell these stories about my experiences growing up and unavoidably talk about how much I love food and how sort of intrinsic that is to my nature. I sort of told you the organic way that the army story came together in Displacement, but let's see, in French Milk it was all over the place because it was my first one, and I think Paris is really the vehicle for that. Story of me being a mess at age 20, which is kind of nice because Paris is like dark and broody and like chaotic and sexy and stuff. And so I think that I've been incredibly lucky with the way that it's happened organically. But I also like for the Paris one, I read a lot of like Emma Kate Fisher. I read a lot of like books about Paris and sort of got into the mindset of like the romantic writers in Paris and Hemingway and stuff. And so that I had a little bit of context ahead of time. I read, before Displacement, I read David Foster Wallace's supposedly fun thing, I'll Never Do Again, which is like the best cruise writing I've ever read. It was hilarious. And of course I didn't read this until I had already agreed to go on this trip. And then it was like, oh, whoops. So I find like humor and fiction, to be really, really helpful in sort of getting me, a little bit aware of what I'm going to experience on these trips ahead of time. I think that's the case. And with food, like, I've just been obsessed my entire life. If it sounds like I know what I'm talking about, it's because I'm like a uber food fan, and I'm very lucky to know people who know about food, like my mother and my father, who are just big foodies also.
Thank you. Relish was my favorite. I started with French Milk that I found at the library, and ever since then I was like, okay, get my hands on more of this.
Awesome, thanks.
And my boyfriend's a chef, so reading Relish really gave me insight into, because I got the book right around the time when I started dating him.
Oh, perfect.
So it kind of like came along at the perfect time, and I was like, oh, so this is what it's like to like be obsessed with food from like a chef's perspective. But anyway, I just had a question about, since I'm an artist myself, what is your artistic process like? What materials do you use? And just would love to know more about that.
Sure. I have a couple different things that I do. Most of my comics are drawn with Faber-Castell pit pens. I started drawing with them in college, and I liked them because they are waterproof and light fast. They don't like fade away. I was kind of a super pen nerd, and I was like trying everything that I wanted to like see what it does on paper, and I keep coming back to those, and they don't last very long. Like, I go through one a week basically, and I keep having to buy them, and I'll do this thing where I'll buy like 5 or 10 of them at a time, and then I won't have to come back, and then I'll forget, and then I'll buy another 5 or 10. So like I have drawers that are just full of them, and I'm like, I don't know which ones are new and which ones are used. And so those are awesome. They're great pens. I like a lot of different papers depending on what I'm doing. If I'm watercoloring, I need a different paper than other stuff. But I like a non-bleedy paper. And what I do for all of my travelogue work, because I'm really snotty about a lot of the stuff that's in sketchbooks, and because I don't want to like have to rip it out of the sketchbook to scan it, is I make my own using hole punchers and book rings. Because it's so easy to just unclip the book ring, and then you can put it down on the scanner and put it back into its little case. So that's really nice, and I get to like choose the paper I want to use and choose the size that I want to draw at and stuff like that. But this is, you know, always an experiment. Every single one is like, I'm gonna try it this way. With Displacement, this was the first one that I was like, I'm gonna watercolor every single page of this travelogue as I go, which was insane, but it ended up being this kind of like nice meditation every night to like sort of get myself to sleep. And because the colors are so vivid in the Caribbean, that I was just like, have to get it down the blue. And it's such a sort of intimate story about my grandparents, that I wanted color to be a part of it, and I wanted it to be kind of this tactile color thing. So for, you know, it changes for every project. Right now, I'm working on the wedding book, and it's black and white, and I'm going to do the color digitally, and I'm doing it all in Faber-Castell pens on like goofy, nerdy, like manga paper stuff that I found that's really not bleedy. It's really nice stuff, and it's, you know, I'm working at 9x12. And this is all partly experimental discoveries that I've found just by doing and making lots of mistakes, and partly talking to other artists and seeing what works for them, and finding new tools through people who love a certain pen or a certain kind of paper.
Thank you.
Sure. Go to a Mocha Fest and ask people what they use and steal their ideas.
Oh, I loved it. I went last year. It was great.
Nice. Nice.
All right, we have time for, I think, one more question.
Hello.
Hi.
I got Relish as a Christmas present a year, I think 2 or 3 years ago now, and I work in food, and it was absolutely mind-blowing. So I've been just been steadily accumulating your stuff, and I found out about this by accident because I was buying someone's Christmas present here.
Cool.
So I was really
You're a little
happy.
Late.
Well, it's a Secret Santa gift.
Okay, perfect.
And people who work in food don't have lunch during
it's
the holidays.
It's true, yeah. Like the holidays, that happens later.
You were mentioning some artist names whom I already love, like Art Spiegelman and Craig Thompson. What are you currently, or have just, like, read? What are you loving? What are you, like, recommending to people? What are you reading over and over again right now?
Ooh. Oh, what am I reading? I love these questions. I just had this fun experience where I read a lot of YA, unabashedly, love it. And I had read Stephanie Perkins' new anthology about the holidays. Great Christmas present, by the way. It's called My True Love Gave to Me. It's really good. It's all like YA authors writing like really cute love stories, and they're all really nice. And so I read it and I was like, this is awesome. And I read like one of her other books. Her first one is like Lola and the French Kiss, or Anna and the French Kiss, thank you. and I was like, oh, this is really cute. And then somebody tweeted at me that they were like, oh, I like to see worlds that, you know, literary worlds converge. I liked it when they referenced Lucy Knisley and Stephanie Perkins' new book. And I was like, what? That's insane. And so I read the subsequent two books that are all sort of like sequels to Anna and the French Kiss. And the character in the recent book is a graphic novelist, and he reads my work. He's like, he has one of my books on his shelf or something like that. And I was like, this is so cool. This is so cool. Like, I have been reading YA since I was a YA. And I've never, like, I'm famous. I'm in the book. I'm new. This is, I finally made it. That was the, like, turning point.
Hit the big time now.
That's right. Yeah, I'm in a book that I read. Like, hooray. So that was really cool for me. I've just finished reading all of those and being really nerdy about it, and then I made a bunch of like fan art for her because I was like, oh, it's gonna come back around all the time, forever. And when I was growing up, like, the author was sort of this unknown entity to me, and to sort of have the ability to have a connection with the people that I read is like both terrifying and awesome to me. Like, terrifying in a way because I'm like, you don't exist in real life. Which is, I think, the way that some people might feel when they meet me. They're like, you're not allowed to be alive right now. You're supposed to be on paper. But I'm like the biggest nerd of them all. So I just get really crazy about that kind of thing. So of course I was like obsessed, and I sent Stephanie Perkins the art. I was like, this is for you. So I read those. They're really cute. I think I loved the holiday anthology as a like recommendation the most, because it's like a whole bunch of different stories and different authors and stuff. So like, you'll find something that you like. What else? I just got a lot of really good Christmas books, so I'm like making my list now.
I saw you mention on Twitter that you read In Real Life by Jen Wang.
Yes.
Amazing. Jen Wang is a great comic, like a great cartoonist.
She's so good.
Her graphic novel, Coco Be Good, is one of my favorite things ever, so I highly recommend.
Oh, it's amazing. And In Real Life is really, really good too, and sort of about the convergence of digital life and real life and the sort of politics that are involved. Jen Wang, and she's such a good artist.
So good.
So good. She and I were both at Comic-Con this year, and I remember through my publisher, I'd gotten an early release of In Real Life, which was awesome, and I'd gotten to read it early, but they were like, don't tell anybody that we gave you this early. And I was on a panel, and I was like, have you guys read In Real Life? It's so good. It's awesome. And they were like, that's not out yet. And I was like, oh, what are you talking about?
I actually, I didn't get an advanced copy through any publisher. I just found it here.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, because what happens, I think, and like, I think what had happened was, I think somebody had gotten an advanced copy. I don't know who.
Right,
and
they sold it.
I found
and they
Relish
sold
here,
like two weeks before it was on sale. And I was like, whoa. Yeah. Yeah, Strand, what are you doing?
Yeah. Yeah, no, both of those. In Real Life is just absolutely lovely, and Coco Be Good is beautiful, so.
Cool. Well, on behalf of the Strand, thank you both, Lucy and Marie, for coming out. Thank you all for coming out as well. More copies of Lucy's books are available at the back of the room for purchase. Feel free to stick around, get your book signed, hang out. Thanks.
Thank you.
I'll do a little drawing.